Good morning and thank you for having me here. Coming to FICCI is almost like homecoming. If I said it was homecoming, maybe you'll give me a day job here, which I think I'm not qualified to accept. But I've chaired in the last several years and been a member of juries on CSR, on higher education, on health, and I think I've lost count of the number of times that I've had to come here and be a part of the FICCI effort to identify excellence. Let me make a few prefatory statements before I get on to the Kotak Committee report. Everyone and his uncle has views on the Kotak Committee report because everyone and his uncle has views on corporate governance. And you get articles commenting on the recommendations, expressing unhappiness at recommendations that don't exist, commenting on the inadequacy of recommendations that seem to be heading in the right direction, castigating those that are heading in the wrong direction. You get the entire bunch. And what I'm going to share with you over the next 25 minutes to half an hour is more of the same. It's not going to be materially different from what you've seen, what you've heard, what you've read, and what you have arrived at in your own minds after looking at the report and the recommendations. Some of you might have seen an article in yesterday's newspapers by Mr. Rahul Bajaj and Mr. Omkar Goswami on the Kotak Committee recommendations. Let me start with that. Not that I wish to comment on the points that they've made, but just to say, and I'm sure it must be music to the ears of some gathered here in this room, there was a time in this country when government policy was based on the principle seeing eye to eye with CII. We moved on. So persons that talk in terms of the reports that they wrote several years ago, persons that talk about their experience on companies allegedly, and I use the word allegedly fairly deliberately, allegedly good companies in the corporate governance space, I believe are by definition ill-equipped to comment on what this country needs by way of corporate governance. The one basic truth which many people lose sight of, and it's not new, it's not Indian, this is a phenomenon that exists all over the world, is that good people, law-abiding people, those who don't do the right things because of the fear of the policeman at the elbow, such people believe that the world is getting over-prescriptive, too many rules and regulations are getting laid down, we didn't need any of these, we conducted ourselves very well. So why do you need to write out this very elaborate framework? Somewhere we miss the point that there can only be one set of rules to govern one set of activities, and that they will apply equally to good and bad people, good and bad organizations. So when you write rules which are prescriptive, which seem cumbersome, and which are often cumbersome, let's not get away from it. You get the feeling, isn't this a bit too much? I was doing all of this much before these rules and regulations came. I had a conversation with Dr. J.J. Irani. For friends of J.J. Irani, I can tell you I had breakfast with him 3 days ago. He's still the same J.J. Irani, raring to go, even though he claims he's retired and settled down in Jamshedpur. I had this discussion with him when the Irani report was being written, which was supposed to be the basis for the new Companies Act. Ultimately, there is so much difference between the Irani report and the Companies Act that even Dr. Irani will not acknowledge that the Act had anything to do with his recommendations. But he had the same problem. He said, we do this in the Tatas all the time. Why do you need to write these regulations? And I had to tell him, you don't write regulations for the Tatas. You write regulations for the thousands of companies in the listed space and the lakhs of companies that are not listed, which are under the MCA's remit. So I thought I must mention upfront that when we look at the Kotak Committee recommendations and the spirit in which they are written, let us not for a moment forget that these regulations are meant to discipline those who need regulations to discipline them. I think that is one truth that we need to hold on to while we study the recommendations. I have been critical of some of the recommendations. But let me say that this committee was set up with several constraints. Firstly, it was a 25-member committee. If you want to transact business, you cannot have a 25-member committee. You have a much smaller committee, and if you want to reflect the various shades of opinion of all stakeholders, you certainly invite them to the committee meetings. You take their views on board. They don't have to be members. The associated problem is that this committee somewhere saw itself as a drafting committee. Now, when 25 people set out to rewrite the draft, firstly, you're prisoners of an existing LODR. Then you make amendments. You fall prey to incrementalism. You can't make fundamental changes. And if 25 people, including heavyweight lawyers, are on the committee, you can imagine what the output is going to be. And if you factor in that constraint, it hasn't been a terrible job. It could have been worse. I mean, let me look at the brighter side. When I was going through those, I thought in terms of one of the major problems of Government of India reports, which is the problem of multiple authorship. For that matter, even the Companies Act 2013 is a problem of multiple authorship. Different parts of the Act were written by different people, and therefore there are parts of the Act that don't talk to each other, which are inconsistent. They look in different directions. And we've seen enough instances of that in the Companies Act. So here with 25 people, a time frame of 4 months, and most important, the terms of reference. Some of you might have seen the terms of reference. I brought this here because I needed to read out to you two of the terms of reference. There are 7 terms of reference. 7 is normally a lucky number, but let me read out to you the first term of reference. I'm sure many of you are familiar with this. To make recommendations to SEBI on ensuring independence in spirit of independent directors and their active participation in the functioning of the company. Leave the active participation out for the moment. Ensuring independence in spirit of independent directors by writing regulation. I was reminded of an old ad many of you might have seen. There are some things money can't buy, for everything else there's MasterCard. You remember that ad? So in our life and our work, there are some things that regulations cannot fix. For everything else, you can have laws and regulations. And one of the things that regulations cannot fix is your mental state, is your honesty, your integrity, your independence. These are not the subject matters of legislation. As Alan Greenspan famously observed when he was not bringing down the interest rate, which was his day-to-day job. Was bringing down the interest rate. I think he made a sensible statement. For a change, which was that you cannot legislate for honesty. So to task a committee with ensuring independence in the spirit of independent directors was, I believe, asking for the moon and a little more. What they have done in response thereto, I'll touch on very soon. There are 5 others which are fairly routine items. So I'll jump from the 1st to the 7th. Any other matter as the committee deems fit pertaining to corporate governance in India. So In my first conversation with Mr. Uday Kotak, after this had become public, the terms of reference, long before the committee started to meet, he reached out to me asking whether I had any thoughts on this. So I told him, yes, ignore the first six recommendations, the terms of reference, focus only on term number 7, which is any matter, forget any other matter, just say any matter as the committee deems fit pertaining to corporate governance in India. That's the only term of reference you do need. You don't need the other six. My expectation then was, and it's been belied by what transpired later, was that this was a huge opportunity for a committee as big as this, as strong as this, as experienced as this, to write on a clean slate, to forget what existed, to pool their experiences in terms of what is required for today, for tomorrow, and the day after in terms of a governance framework, and to write without being constrained, without being circumscribed by what exists today. Regrettably, they didn't travel down that path. They chose to take the existing LODR as a given and then make a few changes, drafting changes. So basically, this was a committee which was making changes in the track mode, even though one union minister, interestingly from the railways, said that the committee had gone off track. In a comment shortly thereafter, I said he was using the appropriate phraseology for the railway ministry. But be that as it may, the point anyhow is that a report of this significance should not have been attempted by making changes in track mode on what exists. The other problem that this report has is that it has two, for want of courage, they have not called it notes of dissent, but they've called it addenda to the report. These are communications from the ministries of corporate affairs and finance. One of them has questioned the rationale of many of the recommendations. In a long laundry list of item-wise comments, they have given the comments. I will not trouble you with those, but allow me to comment on one sentence only from the letter of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and I think it is worth reading. So with your permission, let me quote that one sentence. It talks about how SEBI, through this committee, is attempting to intrude into the MCA's turf. That is the theme song here. But this one sentence is very interesting. It says, reasons such as improving public accessibility through disclosures may not be sufficient enough reasons for extending jurisdiction, as the disclosures made under either of the jurisdictions are publicly available. And this is preceded with an observation that you need to examine whether these can be covered through subordinate legislation under the Companies Act, whether it's cost effective, are the benefits adequate when you incur these costs, and whether this relates only to listed companies or you're trying to get to the area of unlisted companies. Now, somewhere in all of this, if you read through this, you get the feeling that the fundamental change that the Indian markets, as well as markets worldwide, made around the same time in India in 1988, when SEBI was set up as a non-statutory body, was moving from a merit-based scheme to a disclosure-based regime. Earlier, it was a controller of capital issues who decided who could raise money in the market, how much could be raised, at what time it could be raised, at what price it could be raised. That was, for some reason, called a merit-based scheme. Because merit, like beauty, lay in the eyes of the beholder. If he thought it was good, and I say he advisedly, because the country was not privileged to have a lady holding the position of controller of capital issues. So if he thought, the controller of capital issues thought it was a good issue, you raise capital. If he didn't think it was a good issue, bad luck, come back again. With your proposal looking a little better, maybe with the proponent looking a little better, and then maybe your proposal will go through. So the shift from there to a disclosure-based regime is in effect what is being negated by the letter of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, though it does not say that much in so many words. And I think it's important to recognize that if this is the view of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, you are not going to make significant progress in the matter of putting in place a more meaningful and pragmatic corporate governance regime. As for the Ministry of Finance, the comments could have been better drafted, I thought. I'm somewhat old world when it comes to drafting. And they don't even touch on the major issues contained in the report. They deal with the peripheral issues in the report. Having said all of that, let me touch on what exactly the committee has said and what I think of these recommendations. The committee starts with issues of board composition. It says a minimum of 3 is not good enough. You need to have a minimum of 6. I think it's a great recommendation for the simple reason that if you have 4 mandatory committees, and mind you, this deals with listed entities, 4 mandatory committees of the board, and you have 3 directors on the board, one of whom would be non-independent, and the committee composition prescribes for certain number of independent directors on each of the board, you really will not get enough people to populate 4 committees. You'll get the same set of 3 people. You can call it a board meeting once. After that, you can call it a committee meeting or in the opposite sequence. But you'll have the same bunch of guys, and you're not factoring in the wealth of experience at the board level that a company needs in order to do the 3 things that a board is required to do. There are only 3 things that a board is required to do: superintendence, direction, and control. There is no 4th thing that is expected of the board. You don't get into the area of operations. You don't get into the area of management. You don't get into unnecessary detail. The job of the board is to ensure that the management does its job well. That's it. Somebody put it very well. I was with the Tatas 3 days ago in Jamshedpur, breathing air of a much better quality, I can assure you. And I was interacting with a bunch of directors of their subsidiaries, and one of them said, when I asked, what do you think is the job of a board, he said, to ensure that management does its job honestly. Honesty has several connotations to it. Now, if that's the job of a board, you need a board that is reasonably strong, just not in terms of the arithmetic of board composition, but even in terms of the experience, not just the numbers. And I think mandating 6 directors on the board is a good recommendation. Now, in that board, they have said that the lady director who is on that board, I'm assuming that most companies do not have more than one, should be independent. I have for long felt that reservation for women in boardrooms is an insult to Indian womanhood. I think we men have failed to look beyond our noses and to see the vast ocean of talent that the other gender can bring to the boardrooms. And maybe for reasons of our insecurity, our collective insecurity in the boardroom, which could be challenged if a woman came in and asked the right questions. Maybe because the old boys club did not have membership for women. It could be that. So we had very cozy boardrooms, which went through the motions of conducting board meetings. So we didn't reach out to women of substance. And therefore, the government decided it would legislate and say, you must have a woman on the board. Now, the charge against most companies is that in order to meet this requirement, you got your daughter or your wife or your niece or whoever on the board, and many people have criticized that. I have again made my view public on this, which is that there is nothing wrong with getting your wife, your daughter or your niece on the board. Certainly not worse than getting your son or your nephew or your husband on the board if you're a lady promoter. If you can do that, there's no reason why, just because it is another gender, you tend to be overly critical of the fact that there is a relationship. But my own belief is, and I think this is where the committee fell short, if you wanted an independent director, the provision to make should have been that a company should have at least two women directors, at least one of whom should be independent. It would have ticked every box that you needed to tick, ensured that there were two women in the boardroom. Even today, in this day and age, the Companies Act is now 4 years old. In this day and age, there are people referring to women on the board as woman director. I have seen statements of board composition where the category of director says non-executive, somewhere it says independent, somewhere it says promoter, and somewhere it says woman director. Now, for God's sake, that's not why the lady is on the board. You brought the lady in to bring her contribution in terms of experience and in terms of expertise. And you call her a woman director till kingdom come, you will have a category called woman director. I think it is something that certainly to me is anathema, and it should not exist. Then if you go beyond the composition of board directors, it talks in terms of something which can at least raise eyebrows, which is that you must put out for the consumption of the shareholders annually the experience, the specializations, the contribution, the potential contribution of your directors. I cannot understand how this will change from year one to year five. When you induct somebody on board, you assume that the NRC does its homework properly, identifies what it is that is missing in the board by way of experience, and then you get the person on the board and the shareholders endorse that at the AGM, unless the shareholders and Indian shareholders have not been known to even discuss the appointment of director, forget vote against the appointment of a director. So it goes through without any resistance, without any comment or analysis. So to that AGM, if every year you were to take a statement showing the experience of your directors, how will it change materially from the year in which you've inducted that director? And then you want your directors to be trained every 5 years on aspects of governance. Now, if you've been 5 years on the board and you haven't learned what governance is, what your role is, what you're supposed to do, I think in year five, it is time to respectfully show the door to that person rather than invest time, energy, effort, whatever, in training that person on what governance means. I think that's a recommendation that is barking up the wrong tree, to put it very mildly. You also have provision for evaluation of directors. Now, evaluation, I think it's beyond argument that as a concept, evaluation is an excellent thing. Forget directors. There are several things that resonate in our life and work we evaluate to see whether mid-course corrections are required, to see whether there are things you need to do differently, to see whether there are things you need to do additionally, other things you need to abandon, things that are not relevant, which you've done so far. So evaluation by its nature is a good thing. The problem with board evaluation is the provisions in Schedule 4 of the Companies Act. And if you look at the last line of Schedule 4 when you have the time, it says based on the evaluation, you will decide whether to keep a director or let that director go. So it's black or white. It doesn't talk in terms of evaluation, showing up what are the areas for improvement of that director and working on those areas of improvement. Having inducted somebody, kept him or her on the board for some time, then you decide, no, in evaluation it doesn't measure up. Luckily, we haven't got to that stage in India, because every director at the end of evaluation gets 6 out of 5 or 11 out of 10, depending on whether you use a 5-point scale or a 10-point scale. There's only one interesting evaluation report which I saw, which said against an item called conflict of interest, somebody had 4.915, and I asked the person who showed me that report, how can you get, if conflict of interest, you're 0 or 5. You can't have 4.9. It turned out that this was a question-based evaluation attempted by 10 directors, one of whom thought 10 out of 10 is only God's score. So put 9 against every item, including conflict of interest. So when you average it out, it ended up as 4.9. So what the Kotak committee should have done is to scrap all of that and to put just one sentence in its place which said that every board shall annually undertake a meaningful evaluation having regard to its size, its operations, etc., etc., in order to make improvements in the functioning of the board and its constituent member spirit. You can draft it whichever way you want and leave the mechanics. Let me share one instance with you. One company, a big company in India, decided to undertake evaluation strictly following the letter of Schedule 4 of the Companies Act, which says that the evaluation of directors shall be done by the entire board except the director who's being evaluated. So the first director was asked to leave the room while he was being evaluated, and he was called back after 3 minutes and told it's over. Good, he's come back. The second one took 3 minutes. The third person was out for 27 minutes. Can you imagine what thoughts must have been going through his mind when he was outside? He'd finished making or responding to all the missed phone calls that had come till then. He'd send the mandatory emails that needed to go out, and yet he was outside, yes, waiting to be called in. And he was comparing. The other two went in 3 to 4 minutes, so clearly nobody said anything. So what is it they're discussing about me? Because it's my performance, my contribution that's being discussed. So he was called back, and then the proceedings resumed. And through the rest of that meeting, and maybe for much later, he continued to look at the other members on the board to see who was the one that was not looking him in the eye, because then you know who kept him out for 27 minutes. That is not evaluation, friends. If you undertake evaluation that way, you will get nowhere. A meaningful evaluation, which is a means to an end. Evaluation is not an end in itself. The means to an end, it's in order to find out what's going wrong, what needs to be improved, and how do you fix that. The Kotak committee has not traveled in that direction. It has said disclose what you have, the method you put in place, and things of that kind. Simply doesn't do enough, if you ask me. It should have said much more as far as evaluation is concerned. Then the number of board meetings. It says you must have a minimum of 5 meetings. 4 is not good enough. Why 5? Why not 6? So they identified 3 or 4 items which they said do not get discussed in quarterly meetings, and therefore you need a separate meeting. What are those? Risks, succession planning, things of that kind, 3 or 4. Now, I'm not aware of a company where risk is waiting for 12 months to tell you, you know, my turn is coming for discussion. So you were busy with the 4 quarters accounting. So now, you know, now it's my turn. Succession planning will wait for 12 months. God knows, given our, I wish you all long lives, but given the traffic conditions on our roads, sometimes succession planning cannot wait for 12 months. So you can't have that kind of a prescriptive arrangement. You certainly need to. I would have been happy if he had said, why 5? I have 6. One of the ministries, and I don't know, don't even want to say which, but I'm sure you'll find out if you read it, has said, you know, this increases cost. Can you imagine a board meeting being looked at as a cost? Why have a board? If a board meeting, and the board is supposed to provide guidance to the company, if you look at that as cost, clearly you're having a problem in the way you're approaching governance. If you get to committees of the board, they've tinkered around the committees. The one committee that I'm personally very fond of, I must make a disclosure, and where I feel hopelessly disappointed, is the stakeholder relationship committee. When the old shareholder grievance committee was renamed as the stakeholder relationship committee, I thought there was hope now for other stakeholders. So having renamed it, the Companies Act said it will deal with the grievances of security holders. So from shareholders, you move to securities holders, incremental move, but not looking at the other wide universe observing of stakeholders that you have out there. Because this is the age of stakeholder democracy, not shareholder democracy. We've moved from shareholder to stakeholder long ago, and I hope we are not going in the reverse direction. It also moved from a grievance committee to a relationship committee. What the Kotak committee has done is it has focused on the relationship aspect of the committee. You need to reach out to shareholders. You need to find ways to address the problems, which is dangerous again. You could be getting into a case-wise approach to shareholder problems rather than systemic issues. Committees of the board should look at systemic issues unless there is some case that is sticking out, crying for attention, which again might point to a systemic issue. But the minute relationship translates to dealing with individual complaints at the board level, you are clearly stepping into the area of management, and that is something you shouldn't be doing. And as for the other stakeholders, they remain unaddressed in the Kotak committee, at least through this committee. I'll give you a very interesting example of how important this committee is. In southern India, there is an iconic IT company. In this audience, I need not take names, I think. Where somebody described by the friendly English media as founder, promoter, what have you, had a number of grievances against the board and the management. He chose to use the media to communicate to the board and the management. The management, in turn, chose a law firm to communicate to him. So here was a promoter from the outside communicating through the media to the board, and the board communicating to him through a law firm. When this whole thing blew up, the issues in that company blew up, the chair of the Nomination Remuneration Committee made a statement, because one of the issues that was under the scanner was relating to the NRC's terms of reference. The audit committee chair, the person, had a statement to make. The only person missing in action and the only committee missing in action was the stakeholder relationship committee. Now, this gentleman was a stakeholder. This is a board committee. It was supposed to reach out to him. Everyone else in the board made statements. You went to him through a law firm, and the stakeholder relationship committee was missing in action. I would have expected that experience to be captured in the Kotak committee findings. There are what might interest you is that the promoter's business, reclassification of promoters, there is a recommendation which makes life a lot easier. It has moved the shareholding from 1% to 10%. If you're below 10%, you could opt out if that recommendation is accepted. And then there is something which worries me a little. This is the attempt to dilute, if I may put it bluntly, the prohibition of insider trading regulations of SEBI. The prohibition of insider trading regulations permit for the flow of information to persons who normally should not get that information, only if the purposes are legitimate. But the legitimacy is not defined anywhere. The context in which that flow could be legitimate is not defined anywhere. There has been an attempt made to address that in the committee. So what you have is a recommendation for an agreement between persons who are designated as counterparties, namely the promoters, and the company for flow of information which in the ordinary course would not flow to them because of the PIT regulations. Somebody says it's the PITs, but I won't go that far. The PIT regulations, prohibition of insider trading. Now, the substantive part of that long recommendation is that what your nominee on the board gets to know, you should also get to know. And I always thought that the nominee was a nominee of the person who nominated that person to the board. And therefore, if the nominee got the information, it would be reasonable to expect that the nominee would not hold the information back from the person that nominated him. So why do you need to provide for a parallel information flow to somebody who has a nominee sitting in the boardroom? Now, in another iconic company, which this time is not in southern India but in Mumbai, you found flow of information which was hugely violative of the need-to-know principle. Underlying this is the need-to-know principle. Who needs to know? How much does that person need to know? When does that person need to know? You violate that and you're buying a problem. Corporate governance is premised on only addressing two issues, nothing else. Conflict of interest, which is why you have the RPT restrictions in place, and asymmetry of information, which is why you seek to address insider trading or the prohibition of the flow of information to those that don't need the information. On auditors, there's a recommendation, which is a very healthy recommendation, which is bringing auditors within the disciplinary ambit of SEBI. Now, if I know auditors have opposed it, I know that the institute has strong views. The institute says that we are doing a good job of regulation. Prime Minister of India has a different view, as we read in the newspapers. And clearly, and I don't hold this against any professional body, there are those that have track records much worse than the auditing profession has in terms of self-regulation. But a professional body is by design ill-equipped to undertake the extent of regulation that needs to be undertaken. Self-regulation does not travel beyond a certain distance. And I think that considering the importance of the auditors and the fact that the average shareholder and other stakeholders depend on what the auditors say, it's important that auditors are subject to regulation by the securities market regulator. There's a larger philosophical question, and then I will stop. In the preface, it has been stated that the attempt of the committee has been evolutionary rather than revolutionary. Now, if you look at the history of revolutions in the world, and luckily not in the governance space, but only in the political space, revolutions have targeted structures of governance, rarely the content of governance. A committee on corporate governance looking at content is expected to be evolutionary, but the way it has been stated upfront in the report seems to indicate that this is the defense case being made out for not doing enough in what follows in the report. What I was told by the chairman of the committee, and I'm sure he will not mind my telling this to you, is even with this business, we've run into objections from the ministry. Therefore, we could not have really done much more. To which my response was, considering that even this has got your objections from the ministry, I think you should have said all you needed to. It would only have got you objections, nothing more than that. Maybe the objections would have been more, but at least you would not have been found wanting. Nobody would have said you pulled your punches, didn't say it like it is. broadly, that is what I thought I would share with you if I went through this entire report. We could be here till at least tomorrow evening. I have no intention to do that, but it is interesting reading. Interesting not in the sense the Chinese use the word interesting when they say, may you live in interesting times, not those. It's not that harmful for the economy. There are good points in it. I've said elsewhere, like the curate's egg, it's good in parts, bad in parts. I am told, as of this morning, I spoke to somebody in SEBI, they was told that a lot of comments have come in the report. The sense is that 2/3 to 3/4 of this will get translated to regulation. There will be some that will fall by the wayside because of the objections of the ministry. Now, the mechanics of how this regulation will take place is interesting. When it is drafted, it will go to the SEBI board, which has representation from the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. And therefore, there would be an exciting board meeting, I imagine. It certainly will not be a unanimous set of recommendations that will emerge. I would be disappointed if the cut, thrust, and parry that you should expect in meaningful boardroom discussions doesn't take place. But when that is over and done with, you could have the framework which some people describe as needlessly prescriptive. Some others believe falls short even in the area of prescription. I wanted to share one experience with you. In the year 2007, before the financial crisis hit the world, I was present at a meeting of a body then called the Financial Stability Forum, which is now called the Financial Stability Board. I was not representing India. I was a member of the International Organization of Securities Commissions. I was one of the two delegates. So in the morning, we had 8 of the CEOs of 8 of the top 10 companies by market cap in the United States, interacting with about 15 of us. And what they said was this: don't write regulations that are prescriptive. Just have principles-based regulation. Simply state a few principles and leave it for us. Which, where they came from, was fine. In the afternoon, we had a meeting with the heads of compliance of those same bodies who said, just tell us everything up to the last comma. Should things go wrong, it is our heads on the chopping block, not the chief executives. We are the goalkeepers. If the ball goes past us, the goal is scored. We want to ensure that what is exactly expected of us should be told to us in sufficient details so that we know that we are compliant or non-compliant. Therefore, this problem will always continue. Should we have self-regulation? Should we have no regulation? Should we have that fictional creature called light touch regulation? There's nothing called light touch regulation. It's either regulation or light touch. You can't have light touch regulation. Or should we go the whole distance and write out a code of conduct governing every aspect of our work? Codes of conduct don't help either. A company called Enron had a code of conduct that was 64 pages long. Thank you.